research about oceans in order to answer our question, how can we best preserve the oceans?
The ocean has many different life-supporting roles that make it crucial for our survival. The ocean covers more than 70% of the Earth's surface, so without it, our Earth would basically turn into a desert. It provides life for marine organisms, like habitats, food, and water. 97% of the Earth's water is found in the ocean, so if the oceans ran dry, there would not be enough water to support life, resulting in extinction of many different species. It drives climate weather and stabilizes global temperature by absorbing and distributing radiation from the sun. It generates more than 70% of atmospheric oxygen and absorbs carbon dioxide, basically shaping planetary chemistry. And many people believe that we need to implement long-term plans to help preserve our oceans.
In order to answer our question, we must first understand the problems associated with it. Global warming is the main culprit to the problems the oceans face today. It is caused by excess CO2 in the atmosphere from the burning of fossil fuels. This excess CO2 is absorbed by the ocean and causes ocean acidification and the death of coral reefs. An increase of temperatures, even as low as 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, can cause mass extinction, severe storms, droughts, and floods. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change says that sea levels can rise anywhere from 1 to 4 feet by 2100, and it's caused by the melting of ice caps. Warmer temperatures are perfect for the formation of algae blooms, which can kill fish and cause neurological and respiratory problems in humans.
Our oceans are a huge carbon sink that absorbs CO2 from the atmosphere. The carbon combines with carbonate or ions and forms a harmful chemical reaction. In shellfish, this chemical reaction prevents the formation of the calcium carbonate shells. Also, increased CO2 levels were found to impair the mental processing of clownfish by the National Museum of Natural History. Lower pHs make it more difficult for coral reefs to withstand stressors as well. Finally, according to the IPCC, the ocean's pH could drop 0.3 units by the end of the century, faster than it has during four major extinctions in the last 300 million years. And the picture here shows increased levels of CO2 over time, and the second one shows drops in pH, and the third one shows increased lowering of the saturation of aragonite, which helps in the shellfish shells.
Overfishing is also a major problem that affects our oceans. Not only does it negatively affect our marine ecosystem, but it also hurts humans. According to the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, 47 to 50% of major global fish stocks were fully exploited. But because of the increasing global demand of fish, the fishing industry has also increased dramatically. But the growth in workers does not fully correlate with the growth in catches. The fish harvests have only grown half of the rate of fishing fleets. This is due to the plateau of fish populations, since fish are unable to repopulate due to the increased rate of fishing. According to the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, in 1992, worldwide revenue for fish was $70 million, but the cost of fishing was $85 million, causing a $15 million deficit in that year alone. Not only does overfishing negatively affect the marine ecosystem, but it also hurts the fishing industry as they lose money due to their unsustainable businesses. And this chart shows which major fish stocks are overfished, which is the yes column, and then not overfished is the no.
Alright, coral reefs are home to over 25% of all marine life, and they provide food for coastal communities in developing countries. They provide medicine such as HIV meds, cancer treatments, and anti-inflammatory creams. And they also help curb the effects of erosion. And they house water filtering invertebrates, and they boost business with increased tourism. However, human pollution from industrial and domestic waste, overfishing, and bleaching has damaged them. According to marine biologist Terry P. Hughes for the Center for Coral Reef Biodiversity at James Cook University, up to 60% of coral reefs could be gone by 2030, and 30% are already damaged. And this picture here shows the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. And you can see by the red and the orange colors on the chart to the side that the coral reefs have become damaged since the 1990s and early 2000s. And this picture shows how dramatic the change in coral reefs has been. On the left, you see a normal coral reef, and on the right is a bleached one because of the increased temperature and acidity.
So iron fertilization is one of the solutions that we came up with to try and best preserve the ocean. So naturally, the ocean contains some of the carbon in the atmosphere, and that carbon is a huge source of what contributes to ocean acidification. Scientists have discovered that by implementing iron into the oceans, they can increase the photosynthesis process of phytoplankton. And by doing that, they can exponentially decrease the amount of carbon inside of the oceans as well as the atmosphere. And in this, this is just a picture showing how it actually works. So an implication with this is that even though there's going to be a huge boom of phytoplankton, the population is going to start increasing, which is going to lead to algae blooms. And with algae blooms, the ecosystem starts to deteriorate, and organisms can't live like anymore in that ecosystem. So they're generally going to have to migrate somewhere else, or they're going to go ahead and die. And another implication is that even though there's a huge decrease in carbon, there's been studies showing that there's going to be a nitrite replacement of it. So even though that it's being replaced with a stronger greenhouse gas, and that's something that scientists want to avoid. And in this graph, it shows these two oceans that they're trying to test it on, and the green and shaded area shows how they're trying to target it in order to maintain minimum damage.
The government plays a huge role in creating laws, regulations, and policies that help protect our oceans. The EPA, it works with U.S. government agencies and organizations to help create policies that safeguard our oceans. The government helps do this by creating acts like the Ocean Dumping Act, which prohibits the act of dumping waste or any other harmful material. They also created the Ocean Act of 2000 that established a commission, also known as the National Oceans Report, that envisioned our oceans as clean, safe, and sustainably managed. They are responsible for coming up with detailed recommendations for our lawmakers to help preserve our oceans. Ocean governance is effective and well-coordinated and participatory, and is very successful within the private sector, the public, government agencies. Implications for the policies is, even though they are effective, not everybody follows them, so it basically diminishes the purpose of having them. And the picture is all the organizations that help preserve our oceans around the world.
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration developed catch-year programs to prevent unsafe fishing practices and to reduce the amount of bycatch. The main problem is that fishermen have to reach a daily quota by the end of the workday, and if they haven't reached that daily quota, they have fished in illegal areas. The catch-year program divides total allowable catch so that fishermen are more selective with where they fish, and they are also able to plan better. With the implementation of this program, U.S. fish stocks will increase in dockside value by $2.2 billion. Even though this is a helpful tool for the management of fisheries, according to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, not all of the regions will be helped with this program. Also, this is a voluntary program, so the administration is unable to enforce implementation on certain regions. And this map shows the different regions where implementation.
So scientists have developed a website called the globalfishingwatch.com, and this allows people from anywhere to go ahead and access the locations of commercial fishing boats from all over the world. These boats are tracked through their AIS, which is a navigational system that these boats use to locate each other, and it's sent via satellite and then it's displayed onto the website. And what scientists generally look for is they look for the location of the boat itself, the crew, the actual boat number, the size, and general stuff like that to determine if they're illegally fishing or if they're somewhere that they're not supposed to be. This is generally what you're going to be seeing once you open up the website. The blue dots show where the boats are at, the top right corner. That shows where how many boats are active, as well as you can go ahead and search up a specific boat that you want to see. And at the bottom, there's a timeline where you can go ahead and see how many boats were where over the years and where did they fish at. The issue with this is that fishermen have discovered a new method called spoofing programming. And with that, they can go ahead and display like a fake message through the AIS system and send a fake location to the satellite. So a blue dot is going to show up where they're not actually are. And with this, they can go ahead and practice and have access to doing a whole bunch of illegal stuff. And this generally has a direct impact on the environment, but it's going to lead to global issues. And in this graph, this is a graph made by the ICC, the International Commission for Conservation of Atlantic Tuna. And the blue line generally shows how much these fishermen are allowed to fish over the years, but the dotted line and the red line shows how much in metric tons they're actually fishing.
While researching our topic, we encountered some limitations. First of all, many of the topics are outdated, coming from the 1980s and 1990s. So for topics such as global warming, the sources did not include any information on trends in temperature from the past decades. Also, many of the sources were blocked by the school, so we could not access them while we were in school, only when we were at home. Also, many of the sources provided information on the problems, but no information on the actual solutions to the problems. This was our Works Cited page. It's continued. And if we're excited for our pictures.
We're good. AJ, describe how the content of the team presentation was changed as a result of group discussion.
Well, we originally had a problem that dealt with industrial waste, but we didn't have a solution for it, so we decided to just include it in one of our other slides, like ocean acidification, as like not a separate slide, but just like a part.
Very good. Alyssa, in the future, what change would you make to your group process, and how would you expect that to improve the team presentation?
It would be more helpful if we like talked to each other while we were doing the research, because oftentimes we had some people who might have been absent, or we were just too silent when we were working on it. So if we would have collaborated from the beginning, it would have helped if we wouldn't have researched the same topics and we wouldn't have overlap.
Very good. Rodolfo, in what way did you improve your ability to work with a group as a result of this project?
I think that we were able to coordinate all at points, so we were able to exclude information that we thought we didn't agree, that we didn't need, so we were able to like talk about it and agree on what should be included.
Excellent. Taylor, what is an example of a compelling argument from one of your peers' research that you guys decided to exclude and why?
With algae blooms, we decided to exclude. We excluded because we ran over time when we were presenting, so we just had to shorten our presentation, and that's what we took out.
Very good. And Peter, what do you think was the strongest counter argument to any of the solutions you proposed?
I think that the iron fertilization that would destruct. Could you repeat that again?
Yeah. So, what was the strongest counter-argument to one of the solutions that your team identified and why?
I think the ocean fertilization counter-argument was one of the strongest because it requires a lot more extensive research, because scientists need to go ahead and implement this idea into it without causing the problems that come with it.
Excellent. Very nicely done, guys.